Hi, my name is Natalie Peruse, and I also work with Mike White with Conservation Legacy, and I work within the Southwest Conservation Corps in the Ancestral Lands Program. And I'm running a program to map invasive species throughout the Navajo Nation and with other project partners as well. I'm going to start out with a radio feature that was done by Earth Notes out of KNAU.
This is Earth Notes. Extended drought on the Navajo Nation has been tough on grazing animals and the grasses that usually support them. Hauling in more hay from outside the reservation has been a short-term fix for feeding hungry livestock, but it has contributed to an invasion of noxious weeds. This silent green invasion has spread from seeds and contaminated hay bales, as well as from roadside infestations across the drought-stricken range. Invaders like musk thistle, Russian knapweed, tamarisk, and the aptly named cheatgrass have gained new footholds, often taking over with vigorous growth that can be hard to eliminate. Just locating the weeds across the 17.5 million acres of the Navajo Nation is a challenge. So to combat the threat, a strike force of Navajo and Hopi young adults is helping to fight the unwanted green menace. The Southwest Conservation Corps has partnered with the Bureau of Indian Affairs to train teams of young researchers how to map weed populations. The participants in what's being called the Ancestral Lands Program are also learning to use tablet-based mapping applications and GPS, skills useful for future careers in natural resource management. The crews have been deployed to survey along roads, streams, and rangeland across three chapters of the Navajo Nation in northwestern Arizona. Working on foot, trainees inventory which weed species are present and the area of infestation. They're collecting real data that helps guide weed eradication, as well as fostering a deeper sense of connection between these young adults and their land. Earth Notes is produced by KNAU and the Sustainable Communities Program at Northern Arizona University. I'm Tristan Klum.
Great. So I just thought that was a good introduction to what our program is doing. Our mission, again, is to empower individuals to positively impact their lives, communities, and environments. And the Ancestral Lands Program began in 2008 in the Acoma Pueblo. And we have served over 100 youth in 2015. Our programs range from traditional farm programs to invasive species eradication to invasive species mapping, historic preservation, fence work, and trail maintenance. Some of our crews are place-based, staying within individual like tribal communities. For example, in Acoma, we have a new program that's also in the Zuni community, but then we also have roving crews that work throughout the Southwest. We have crews that are based in Joshua Tree National Park and Mesa Verde and Aztec Natural Aztec Ruins. So it's a pretty comprehensive program. We take an integrated approach to conservation and ecosystem health. We respond to project partner needs, so working with the National Park Service or working with the Bureau of Indian Affairs to accomplish their priorities, and then bringing in youth to grow and develop their skills. And then bringing that together, we're able to establish community improvement because they're working within their own tribal communities, and we also establish like cultural connections while they're out there working within their communities. They have the opportunity to speak with elders and speak within their own languages and stuff like that. And the work that they do, especially like in weed mapping, contributes to future potential projects because once we have areas mapped, then the project partners are able to decide some of their priorities for future management. So in 2015, we were working on, it was a pilot project, and moving into 2016 based on our success from last year, the program's gonna expand quite a bit more. But this past year, we worked with mostly the Western Navajo Agency was our biggest project, working out of Loup, Tulani Lake, and the Bird Springs areas, and roadsides mostly in that area, as well as stream corridors and rangelands. We also worked in the eastern part of the Navajo area with Fort Defiance Agency and kind of in the central part of Navajo Nation with Navajo Partition Lands. We also did a project with it was a collaboration between Glen Canyon and Canyonlands National Parks, mapping weeds throughout Cataract Canyon. So I'm going to start out by talking about our work with the BIA. They manage over 10,000 acres, and they distribute over 10,000, well, close to 10,000, but that's a 2010 number, so I'm guessing by now it's over 10,000 grazing permits. And grazing is a huge issue, just figuring out, you know, how to manage erosion and, you know, weed seeds and all that stuff. The most recent data that they had was from 2009, and that was at a really broad scale that the data was collected. So they don't really have a clear picture, for one, of the extent of the presence of weed species throughout their lands, as well as anything very recent. So they can't really, they haven't had the tools to monitor any treatments that they've done, because they have been doing treatments. So they want to see, if their treatments are effective, and also get some data at a finer scale than was originally collected by the USGS. They didn't really have the resources to do that themselves, and so that's where this collaboration came in. I already talked about the project areas where we're working. There's 50 targeted weed species that we're looking for. I'd say about 10 or 12 of them are fairly common, kind of the, you know, typical suspects of like tamarisk, Russian thistle, Russian olive, etc. But they were also very interested in some things that we don't necessarily see in our area very much, and getting some early detection of those species, such as Japanese brome was one we found, Dalmatian toadflax, things like that. And in the Western Navajo Agency, the priority was mainly roadsides, but in some of our other projects, like for example within the Kimichi chapter, we're working mostly in stream corridors and washes. We recruited local youth for these projects. They pretty much did not have any sort of experience with any sort of data collection or plant identification. They came into the project maybe knowing, you know, what tamarisk and Russian olive is just because of having seen it all over the place. But we provided them with some basic botany, plant ID education, you know, parts of plants, this and that. We also worked with Northern Arizona University botanists they came in and did some of the trainings, but then also developed pretty nice little one-page kind of cheat sheets, like what is shown on the right side of the screen, for each of the 50 targeted species. Because that's a lot of plants for youth to learn that don't have any previous experience with doing any sort of plant ID. To do the data collection, we used tablets as well. We used Android, Samsung Galaxy 10.1 tablets. And they were also taught like some basic GIS editing. They collected attributes such as percent cover, an estimate of the area if they weren't collecting a whole polygon for the plant species, and like the flowering state of the flower or of the plant. So these are the tablets that we used. They were paired with Garmin Glow GPS receivers to create sub-3 meter accuracy within the tablet. We experimented with two different mapping applications. We used the Map It Fast that was referenced in that earlier presentation, but then ended up using Collector for ArcGIS. I found that it moved a lot more seamlessly into GIS, and I, as the person programming it, was able to develop my data dictionary a lot better and to bring it in a little bit more seamlessly, so that worked for me, and then brought all the data into GIS, and that was QA QC'd partially by the crew and then partially when they were done. But they were trained in how to edit and like all their features and double check their data collection. They also collected it on paper too, so we had kind of like a check and balance, making sure that the data was as accurate as possible. Our results, we ended up surveying over 550 miles of roadsides and over 550 acres of rangelands. 24 of the 50 species were identified, and which I thought was pretty impressive, because alongside the, 10 or so common ones, they did find things that I was really impressed by the Japanese brome. It's pretty hard to ID a grass that is kind of amongst a bunch of other grasses, and they did find that. So this is an overview of the area where they were working. This is the work in Western Navajo Agency that they did. This is the Navajo partition land area, including this part down here. And then this is just 1 month of work over in the Kimichi area in Washes. And these are all their data points. And then these are just a couple of quick graphs showing the number of infestations that were found and the total area that is covered. The gray in the back is the total area that each infestation covered, and the bar going up is the total number of infestations. And so it just kind of shows kind of typically, like for example, this is musk thistle here, and so it was found quite a few times, but doesn't cover a huge area, whereas something like Bromus tectorum cheatgrass was found fewer times, but covers a very large area. And then here I have a couple of maps just showing some of the data spatially that was extracted. This is where tamarisk was occurring throughout the Western Navajo Agency in the chapters that we were that we're surveying. And this is Russian thistle. And then this map is weighted. The darker, larger, bolder colors are where there's more dense infestations, whereas the lighter colors show where things were present, but maybe in less density. Another significant project that we worked on was in Cataract Canyon. It was a collaboration between River Restoration Adventures for Tomorrow, NPS, and CSC, or SEC. It's a 2-year project. The first year we did the mapping, and then next year they're going to go back and, based on the information that we collected this year, go back and do some control work after they've identified the priority areas where they want to work. There had not been any previous weed inventories here before, so it was some baseline data, and the Park Service was really excited to be able to have that for their future work. We only had 8 priority species here, and some of them were really known problem species, whereas other ones were early detection. There were pre-selected priority areas that were all basically pretty high-use campsites. And we would split up each day into 3 different boats and try and attack different areas. Let's see. Up here is a map of some of the areas. And one of the problems in working in the backcountry with the electronics is making sure that your stuff all, sorry, I got distracted. That's okay. Is it making sure that your batteries don't run out? And so we use high capacity batteries, but then also solar backup. And in addition to our ecological data results, we measured social benefits, such as like how the crew felt, kind of what Mike was talking about. I used some of the same metrics that were used in the surveys that he pulled to talk to our crews about that. Let's see. Some of the ones I thought that were most important or that showed some of the largest change was, like, I can teach others how to use mapping apps on a tablet. And we actually had one crew train another to do some of the mapping work, and that, like, really reinforced their knowledge in using it themselves. And then also, kind of like Mike was talking about, these are some of the same metrics put to the crews that we had here. Like, I feel like I have the ability to make a difference in my community, shot way up, and I can be a team player in a small group. And then I really like this quote, how did your experience help you grow? And one girl responded, our biggest accomplishments as a crew, she was on a SAW crew before she moved to the GIS crew, so I really like this. Our biggest accomplishment as a crew was completing the GIS mapping task. We were able to complete a total of 148 miles of surveys. Although the terrain was tough and physically challenging, we encouraged each other through challenges. Once we had seen that the partners were impressed and surprised with how much work we had completed, it encouraged us to continue to achieve our goals. I'm very proud of the work that we have completed and was inspired by my crewmates. I'm proud I have grown of how I've grown as a person. Oh, I had one other video, but I don't see it showing up. Oh. This is my colleague, Chaka.
I hope we have a lot to talk about in the future as we move forward. As y'all know, our mission as an organization, where we're coming from, where we believe in, we want to lay the whole thing out. It's empowering individuals to positively impact their lives, their lands, and their communities. And there's a lot of jobs you can go that have some kind of positive intention, but as an Indian person, it usually never gets to that level. It's, as Indians, we have a life at home, a language, ceremonial culture, and we usually have to leave that there, and then we go out into the work world, and it's two different worlds. It's hard to find a safe place where we can really be who we are, and not only be that, but grow as who we are. And we're hoping that this organization can provide some of that safe space for language, for a little bit of cultural knowledge on plants and animals, stories, so that people can grow not just in the white world, but also truly who they are as a Navajo person or Muscogee or any kind of Native person. So that's really our mission, and that's what we're working towards. But it, like anything in the Indian world, we can't make it happen. It takes a whole group. We have to have partners who are on board and really care about the same things. That's why we're partnering with traditional culture programs to make a lot of those connections. And the participants themselves still have to want it. So it's all coming together. So thank you all for playing a part.
And that's all I have.
Thank you. Questions for Natalie?